Good morning, everyone. Isn't it a delight to be able to be here in church, even though we're in Tier 3? Because of the coronavirus situation, we do have to take extra special precautions. There's a current order of service for Advent, and in the inside cover you'll find what those precautions we're taking are. I will just remind you of them during the notices before we go out. But basically, we've got to be sure about maintaining our social distance, and I'm afraid there won't be refreshments after the service. But we're delighted to be sharing in the service with you. I'm preaching this morning and Marilyn is leading. We begin by inviting God's presence amongst us. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We begin with our opening hymn. I'm afraid I haven't got the number in front of me. 221, God is working his purpose out.
Shall come and light the candle with me. Something to read, and then if you it's on the back of our sermon sheet, it's Advent Day. We think especially this Sunday of John the Baptist, who was sent to proclaim God's message of repentance and to prepare the way for Christ's coming. May we respond to his teaching and the call of new life, and turn our lives around to walk in God's ways. And then we go back to page 1 for the response. Life-giving God, inspire us to hear and respond to your call, and welcome him into our lives.
Amen.
Now in the middle of page 1, we have the opportunity to clear away the things that haven't been so great during this past week, to receive God's forgiveness. Lord Jesus, you came to gather the nations into the peace of your kingdom. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You come in word and sacrament to strengthen us in holiness. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You will come in glory with salvation for your people. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
And the prayer for today, the collect, which is in view. God, for whom we watch and wait, you sent John the Baptist to prepare the way of your Son. Give us courage to speak the truth, to hunger for justice, and to suffer for the cause of God. With Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
A reading from St. John's Gospel. Glory to you, O Lord. God sent his messenger, a man named John, who came to tell people about the light, so that all should hear the message and believe. He himself was not the light. He came to tell about the light. The Jewish authorities in Jerusalem sent some priests and Levites to John to ask him, "Who are you?" John did not refuse to answer, but spoke out openly and clearly, saying, "I am not the Messiah." "Who are you then?" they asked. "Are you Elijah?" "No, I am not," John answered. "Are you the prophet?" they asked. "No," he replied. "Then tell us who you are," they said. "We have to take an answer back to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" John answered by quoting the prophet Isaiah. "I am the voice of someone shouting in the desert. Make a straight path for the Lord to travel." The messengers who had been sent by the Pharisees then asked John, "If you are not the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet, why do you baptize?" John answered, "I baptize with water, but among you stands the one you do not know. He is coming after me, but I am not good enough even to untie his sandals." All this happened in Bethany on the east side of the Jordan River, where John was baptizing. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ. Please do be seated. Well, like Marilyn, and I'm sure many of you, I really enjoy the Advent season. That sense of preparing for something exciting. And it's traditional in Advent to remember each Sunday different people or groups of people that helped prepare the way for the coming of Jesus. And this Sunday, the third Sunday in Advent, that's John the Baptist. And I think his words to us this morning are as relevant as they were when he first preached them. So before I share my thoughts on that, let's begin with prayer. Heavenly Father, you sent John the Baptist to speak your word to people. Please inspire my words this morning and all our hearts and minds, that we may hear the life-giving things that you want to us and to do through us. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
So, in Advent, we think about those who helped prepare the way for the coming of Jesus. He didn't just appear out of nowhere with no preparation. God had it all planned over many, many years. But today we're thinking particularly about John the Baptist. And his role in preparing for the coming of Jesus, I think, is pretty obvious. As we heard in this morning's reading, which Mary shared with us, John came to testify that a great light was coming into the world, that Jesus, the Messiah, would shortly appear. Quoting from the prophet Isaiah, John describes himself as, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, make straight or prepare the way of the Lord." Now, that message, I believe, was both a great challenge and an encouragement to people. And I'd like to share both the challenge and the encouragement, which I think John's message brings with you this morning. Let's start by looking at the challenging side of it. At the heart of John's preaching was repentance, and that was symbolised by baptism. Now, I don't know about you, but for me, repentance conjures up some relatively negative images. It might be phrases like repent or perish. Or the idea that repentance means you have to give up all the things that you enjoy and adopt a very puritanical way of life. But that is not what repentance really means. The word which our Bibles is translated as repentance is the Greek word metanoia. And I looked it up in the dictionaries, and they pretty much all say the same thing. They define it as a change or a turning around of life. Now, I think a helpful way of thinking about this change of direction, this metanoia, is to think about a change of direction. That we need to recognise that sometimes we're heading in the wrong direction and we need to head a different way. To use a very simple analogy, if I wanted to get to Canterbury, I'd probably head to the A2. But if I got to the A2, I turned right and went west, I'd be heading towards London and I wouldn't reach Canterbury ever. So I'd actually need to come off at the next intersection, change my direction and head east so that I could reach where I wanted to go. And that's how it is with repentance in our lives. If we want to be in, reach the kingdom of heaven, we need to be heading in the right direction. We need to follow the ways which Jesus shows us and the Holy Spirit guides and enables us to follow. And that's going to mean a change of direction, at least in some things. Perhaps we'll need to start doing something which we've never done before. Perhaps we need to stop doing something which is unhelpful. Maybe if we've got an addiction, we need to own up to that and tackle it. Or maybe it's a simple change of habits. But this change of direction will certainly mean changing behaviours which, if we're honest, we know to be wrong and damaging. Things like stealing or gossiping or mistreating other people. So to that extent, there is a real challenge in repentance. We can't carry on exactly as we are. We have to recognise that there are ways in which we're making mistakes and we need a change of direction in our thoughts, our behaviours, and our lives in general. And I think this becomes clear when we look at another aspect of repentance, a different way of understanding it. If any of you read the Advent Daily Devotions, the last but one, I shared a reflection on the idea of metanoia as repentance. And the literal meaning, if you actually break it down into its two parts, meta and noia, means in English to go beyond the mind. Now that means acknowledging that our view of things is limited and that our ways of looking at things aren't always right. It an expression of that fundamental truth which God announces through the prophet Isaiah. My ways are not your ways, says the Lord. My thoughts are much higher than your thoughts. You and I do not have the mind of God. Whilst we may not know what is truly good and life-giving, God does. And as we're willing to go beyond our own minds and let the Holy Spirit lead us into all truth, we will discover the kind of life which is really good for us and for others. And that leads to the other important aspect of repentance. It actually, as well as being a challenge, can bring comfort and encouragement. Because I think it's pretty obvious, especially at the moment with the coronavirus pandemic, that things are not as they should be. There are things which are difficult and damaging in our lives and the life of the world. We probably long for it to be better. But that is God's desire and Jesus' promise, that we can know life in all its fullness, a life of well-being for us and for others. And as we go beyond our own thoughts and behaviours and change direction to follow God's ways, we can discover more and more of that better life. For example, wouldn't it be wonderful if differences of opinion didn't lead to squabbles and conflict? And wouldn't it be wonderful if the resources of the world were shared fairly so that everyone had plenty? Those kinds of things and many more will happen when we go beyond our own mind, when we adopt an attitude of repentance, being willing to change direction, change how we think and behave to be in line with God. The reason John the Baptist called people to repentance, because without this change of direction in our lives, things can't truly get better. There's a saying, if we do what we've always done, we'll get what we've always got. But our lives and the life of the world can be so much better. This is what God longs for, a life of blessing for all. So, we need to embrace this call to a change of heart and mind, and be willing to let God renew us in our lives. Because then we will be those who prepare the way of the Lord and help make the coming of God's kingdom amongst us a reality. May that challenge but also encourage you this Advent time. Amen.
I'll have a few moments of quiet to reflect on the first one. Our next hymn is number 527, if you want to follow it in the book. On Jordan's Bank, the Baptist Choir announces that the book. the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
And now our intercessions.
Father God, we thank you for your love for all people and your ability to hear us when we pray in faith through the name of Jesus and in the power of the Holy Spirit. Help us, Lord, to rise to those challenges that you set before us, that your will be done. Amen.
Amen.
Father, please be with those who are making an impact on others' lives, the NHS, all care workers, all who work in transport, emergency services, teaching profession, armed forces, those who provide our food and other essential commodities. We pray for those who are ill and need the touch of Jesus. And we pray for those who have been bereaved in these difficult days. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, we pray that all people in this land will be sensible and play their part in keeping everybody safe. Give to all a clear understanding of all that the science recommends, so that the spread of COVID-19 is kept to a minimum, especially as we look forward to a promising future where the virus is defeated. Loving Father, we give you grateful thanks for the way that you have directed the scientists through the whole world in producing vaccines to defeat COVID-19. We pray that the distribution and the use of these vaccines will be truly miraculous, and that all people will recognise your sovereign influence in all that is achieved. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Father God, we pray for our government, for MPs and local councillors. Please help them in the very difficult decisions that they have to make. We would ask that members of all parties would work together for the betterment of the United Kingdom. Father, we pray that you would overrule in all their decisions so that your perfect will is done. We also bring before you our Queen and all her family, asking that you would bless each and every one of them. Lord, in your mercy. Thank you, Father, for all that this season of Christmas reminds us of. We ask that you would speak words of encouragement and love to all who will attend the various services and events that have been arranged for the period from now up to the end of this year. Send your Holy Spirit so that all may experience the excitement and the joy of the celebration of the birth of Jesus, our Saviour. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
As this time of intercession comes to a close, let us now bring before Jesus those who we know who need the healing that you, Lord Jesus, can give. We bring before you, Jesus, Philip, baby Emily, Beatrice, Mandy,
and any known personally to us. Then, Lord Jesus, we bring before you the friends and families of John Beatson, Rosemary Savage, John Orr, Philip Davidson, and Babs Forrest. Asking that you would bring your comfort to each one as they grieve the loss of a loved one. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Would you like to stand for the peace, although we can't meet, might be quite hard to stand. In the tender mercy of our God, the day spring from on high shall break upon us, to give light to those who dwell in darkness and the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you,
and also with you.
Please sit down for the communion. The Lord is here.
His Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children. And welcomed us to sit in the deep fury. In Christ you shared our life, that we might live in him and he in us.
He opened his arms of love upon the cross, and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin.
On the night he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
Father, we do this in remembrance of him. This body is the bread of life.
At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me."
Father, would you do this in remembrance of him, whose blood is shed for all.
As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna.
As Jesus taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory of yours. all share in one bread.
All are welcome at this celebration. It is made ready for those who love God and those who want to love him more. So come, you who have much faith, and you who have little, you who have been here often, and you who have not been for a long time, you who have tried to follow, and you who have failed. Come, not because I invite you, but because our Lord invites you. It is his will that those who want him shall meet him here. Top of page 5, we pray together. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls on the cross, to be a living sacrifice. Set us out in the power of your Spirit, to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen.
To highlight a few notices, all the different ones are on the pew view. Please do take the pew view sheet away with you, it'll give you a reminder and we won't be reusing them. If you haven't already done so, take yourself a copy of the Beacon magazine, and perhaps most significantly, on the inside cover, it's got details of all our Christmas services. And frankly, we're pretty quite excited about what we're able to do in circumstances. And in particular, just to highlight that next Sunday afternoon, in the churchyard at 4 o'clock, there will be carols round the tree. And at that event, because it's outdoors, we're allowed to sing. So carols round the tree at 4 o'clock next Sunday. That will happen regardless of whether it's raining. If it's raining, just bring an umbrella.
Which tree?
It will be the closest yew tree to the clock tower, so out in the area behind that end of the church. It's where the ground is flattest and we can accommodate most people. Also, I mentioned the Advent reflections, and there are some copies of those on the table by the door. If you haven't seen them or would just like to take a copy of them anyway, perhaps read the one about John the Baptist, please feel free to do that. The only other thing that I really do need to mention is just the arrangements for leaving at the end of the service. We do have to be particularly careful at the moment. So as I said, sorry, there won't be refreshments. If I can ask you to perhaps come out row by row. So if the front row come out, and if you're on that side, go that way. That side, go that way. And just if you could go out fairly promptly after the service. We're not supposed to hang around and chat. I know it's a real shame, but it's better to be responsible, isn't it? Our final hymn is one which reminds us that we're looking forward to a real celebration, the coming of Jesus and the good things that that brings in our lives. It's Make Way for Christ the King. And if you want to follow the words, it's number 438. 438, make way.
Peace to love and serve the Lord in the name of Christ.